Assalamu alaikum and welcome to my show, Hum Sab. Late Tuesday morning, Indian military planes violated the line of control, intruding from the Muzaffarabad sector, facing timely and effective response from Pakistan Air Force. They released their payload in haste while escaping, which fell near Balakot. No casualties or damage have been reported, but there's a confusion regarding which Balakot is it. Is it the one adjacent to the Muzaffarabad district, or is it the one inside Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province of Pakistan? Viewers, this is the first time that Indian aircraft had crossed the Kashmir line of control to strike in years since 1971. And if we actually go by the tweet of DGIS PR, then this is the Balakot adjacent to the Muzaffarabad site and not the one inside KP. However, there's still confusion that needs to be clarified. The ties between Pakistan and India have been tense since a suicide bombing in occupied Kashmir killed over 40 Indian soldiers, with New Delhi blaming Pakistan of being complicit in the attack, a charge that Pakistan has denied vehemently and from the get-go. In response to India's allegations, Prime Minister Imran Khan promised New Delhi to conduct an investigation if provided the actionable evidence, but also warned that Pakistan will retaliate if attacked. Now, today's attack, however, seems to be raising the possibility that India was making a calculated bet to assuage public anger but minimize the risk of a major Pakistani military response. A meeting of the National Security Council, chaired by the Prime Minister Imran Khan on Tuesday, rejected Indian claims of targeting an alleged terrorist camp near Balakot and the claim of heavy casualties. Once again, Indian government has resorted to a self-serving, reckless and fictitious claim, the meeting stated. This action has been done for domestic consumption given the election environment, putting regional peace and stability at grave risk, the National Security Council meeting stated. The claimed area strike is open for the world to see the facts on ground. Domestic and international media is being taken to the impact site. I think this is, again, a very important development from Pakistani side, that we're not hiding anything from the international media. Rather, the international media teams are being taken to the site. And having said that, some important questions are raised considering the current situation, that why is India running away from giving any sort of evidence when we have actually given our complete consent and understanding that, you know, if there's some evidence, we're definitely going to take action. Another thing is definitely the timing of the whole scenario, that who is actually going to benefit from this attack? Not Pakistan, certainly. The Crown Prince was visiting Pakistan. Why would we do any such thing to have, that defocused from the main media stream or anything else for that matter? So again, the timing is very important, and the running away from providing any sort of evidence from the Indian government is also very, very important. What will Pakistan do now? The National Security Council meeting that happened today stated that Pakistan will take action as and when desired on its own, given choice of time and place. But having said that, again, it's a very difficult option for Pakistan to retaliate, to restrain or to respond, because again, war, glorifying war at the cost of what? And war definitely is not the solution to anything. We have been constantly pro this concept. We've been constantly telling the world that we desire peace in this region. But again, how is Pakistan going to respond now on diplomatic as well as military level is the main theme of discussion for our today's program. I'm going to introduce you to my guest as we come back from this break. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're joined by Khurshid Mahmood Kasuri Saab, who happens to be the former foreign minister for Pakistan. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. As well as we're joined by Air Marshal Shahid Latif Saab, who's a senior political and defense commentator. Thank you very much again, sir, for joining us. Kasuri Saab, I'd like to start with you. Kasuri Saab, we have been attacked. There has been a clear-cut violation of the line of control. This is an act of war. This is the attack that India has done on the Pakistani land. Now, how do you see that? What led to all this?
Now, having said that, Yes, it is another type of a surgical strike. It's a drama being staged by India. And I had been predicting that the Modi government, which is losing a lot of public support in India, you see, they've lost elections in three recently. They've lost five elections, including three big states to the opposition Congress party, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Chhattisgarh. And there have been a lot of farmer suicides. And after the demonetization, because I follow Indian media very closely, the Indian media itself is saying that, you know, despite the claims by India that GDP is growing very fast, the level of poverty is increasing. And Modi government feels that after demonetization and GST, which have not been well received, particularly by rural India and also in smaller cities, they do not expect the public to support them. And hence, I am not surprised by something like a repetition of the surgical strikes that were staged earlier on. So I'm not very surprised, though I don't think it was wise, because they've jumped to the conclusion. You see, they've painted themselves into a corner. When you raise the pitch to such a level, and the media has been roped in by the government of India, and they are playing this patriotism card all the time. I'll give you one instance. When Prime Minister Narendra Modi sent a letter to Prime Minister Imran Khan, additionally it sent a cricket bats signed by all the members of the Indian cricket team, and that was brought by the High Commissioner. It was a very good gesture. And there was a letter which said he would like to have constructive engagement with Pakistan. When the Prime Minister of Pakistan suggested that the two foreign ministers meet on the sidelines of the United Nations General Assembly, they accepted the offer. Within 24 hours, they had to back down. You know why? They backed out because they realized that they had been so successful in spreading poison against the Muslims in India and against Pakistan as a polarizing tactic, because as I told you, even now, they painted themselves into a corner. There was no proof that Pakistan had anything to do with the attack in Pulwama, whereas there was everything to say, and these are stories by international media, including Reuters, that this young man who became a suicide bomber had been humiliated very badly. His cousin or brother had been killed earlier, and the United Nations Human Rights Commissioner has already reported on gross violation of human rights. So India was trying to turn attention away from what seems to be an open rebellion by the people of Kashmir, and is trying to call it an act of terrorism and divert attention to Pakistan.
Right. Kasturi Saab, giving a briefing on the airstrikes carried out by the Indian Air Forces across the line of control on Tuesday, 26th February, Indian Foreign Secretary said that India has struck the biggest training camp of Jaish-e-Mohammed in Balakot, adding that the facility was headed by Masood Azhar's brother-in-law. Now, the last time IAF internationally crossed border was in 1971, and since then there hasn't been any as such violation. They are calling it a non-military strike. They're calling it a preemptive strike. Now, what should be the response of Pakistan? How are we going to deal with the situation? Because Prime Minister Imran Khan mentioned that, you know, we're not going to wait if there is an attack. So certainly now that there has been an attack, what should and how should Pakistan respond now?
You see, as far as the military is concerned, you can rest assured that they plan for all contingencies. So let's wait for a report from them. The first response, Pakistan has already proved one thing, which they did prove in the 1965 war also. Air Force has proved its ascendancy, that within a few seconds, the Pakistani Air Force was able to get to the skies, and they chased the Indian planes out. So they have established their supremacy in the area. That is one response. Whether an additional response is called for will depend on the level of damage. And also, these things are not generally announced beforehand, because it takes the element of surprise away. But I'm sure what we need to do, apart from what the military will do, they don't need my advice to them because they have a better assessment of what has happened. But diplomatically, Pakistan should be very aggressive. It has been. The foreign minister has been talking to his counterparts. My suggestion would be that the prime minister should talk to some of the Pakistan's closest friends who recently either visited Pakistan or about to visit Pakistan. And I have particularly in mind Turkey, China, Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Malaysia. And Malaysia is an important member of ASEAN. And I'm not suggesting that he should not talk to others, but these are the ones that come to my mind immediately. The foreign minister should talk to all the P5 and the also the members of the European Union and other major Muslim countries. But I think the prime minister should also speak to a few people. And in fact, I had suggested earlier, though I am not going to repeat that suggestion immediately, that after a few days, once the dust settles down, the prime minister, who has a celebrity status, should visit the four major news dissemination centers in the world. They are New York, Washington, London, and Paris. There's a U and Brussels. They have huge Pakistani communities. He will be received at the highest level in the Pakistani community, will give a very big response, and people forget the reception that Prime Minister Narendra Modi received in New York when he went to New York in 2015. Prime Minister Imran Khan is a much greater celebrity and can expect a much greater response. But all these things need to be done. For the time being, once the dust settles down, I won't suggest that. Once it settles down, he should do that. But already, I'm sure that the Foreign Office is not just active, it is hyperactive. It's already established a 24-hour crisis management cell. I know how the Foreign Office operates, and I have full confidence in the working of the Foreign Office and the Foreign Ministry, and the Foreign Minister has himself been very active.
Kasori Saab, do you also think that ahead of the Indian elections, this sort of an attempt was basically a calculated bet by Modi's government to not only assuage public anger, but at the same time, minimize the risk of a major Pakistani military response?
Now, first of all, I have been following the international media. That is being reported to be my office regularly. I do not, with great respect, agree with you that they are buying the Indian story. As I've already told you, The Guardian and Reuters, their story does not they give both sides of the story. That's number one. Number two, Pakistan will give a measured response. I have no doubt about it. In some ways, they have given. As far as the Air Force is concerned, it's established that it did not allow Indian Air Force to ingress into territory in the Azad Jammu Kashmir sector, because 3 to 4 kilometers literally means nothing. It can be a fraction of a second. And therefore, that is one response, because Pakistan Air Force was able to respond so quickly. But diplomatically, I think we have a strong case because of the UN violation of human rights, which has been now reported by the UN's own body, UN High Commissioner for Refugees. We should take full advantage of it. And as far as the Indian public is concerned, you're asking me, you see, if ISPR does what it did last time, takes foreign correspondents immediately to the area that India is claiming, because the reports that were, the photographs were released, it meant nothing. There's a pieces of bomb lying in a deserted area. I think it's excellent that, and since that is precisely the area that the Indians are claiming, so it will carry a lot of weight if the ISPR were to do the same thing that it did after the last so-called surgical strikes. So if you're asking me whether the Indian electorate is going to be swayed, my own impression is, A, if this is done, the opposition will know the truth and they will not allow the government to get away with this jingoistic and misleading act. But secondly, the international community will also find out, but they will also know one thing, that once the spiraling takes place between two nuclear nations, it's highly irresponsible for India to have used air force, because this is an act of provocation. It is more than that has happened in the last 40 years. In the past, there have been there've been shelling across the line of control. So if the Pakistan were to do something, the international community would know that Pakistan is responding. So A, Pakistan has already responded by not allowing them into the territory. B, the ISPR has released photographs. C, if they were to take foreign correspondents, whether this amounts to enough of a response, in military sense, I would leave that to the military. Thank you.
We'll continue with the rest of the program right after a short break. Stay with us. Non-military strike. Having said that, I think the most important takeaway from the New Delhi's presser, official presser today, is that they said that New Delhi is casting this operation as preemptive, not defensive or retaliatory. What does that mean? And what is a non-military strike? If you could describe it for our viewers, please.
I think there are quite a few points that they're trying to make in the statement. Of course, saying that this is not a retaliatory strike, they want to say that this is preemptive. When preemptive strike means that you are preempting something to happen from the other side, and therefore, before that happens to you, you take the initiative of countering it. So that is preemptive. And in other words, what they're saying is that they've gone and attacked the places where they think that the terrorists were being trained. And that is why they are calling it as attack on the hideouts or the training camps of terrorists. So they are painting you as a terrorist country and a place where, as they say, is the heavens for terrorist training. So in one go, they are charging you with many allegations. So I think this is what they mean. And when they say that this is not retaliatory, obviously, although we know it, that this is kind of retaliatory, which is what they have been saying after Palwama, but they don't want to highlight this aspect to the world, as if they want to play it down, because the world has not responded favorably to their accusation or allegation against Pakistan that Palwama was something which was undertaken by Pakistan. So I think these are the few aspects that I can think of that encompass different parts of their statement, and I've tried to tell you what do they mean.
What is a non-military strike?
Non-military strike, that means they are not trying to wage a war against you. And this is a strike which, as they call it, purely preemptive. And they don't want to call it in the military regime, which means they haven't really come to destroy any military targets. And they did not have any military aims, because military aims are such that then they are followed up with many other things. So this, they want to call it as one time, and that too preemptive, and that too against those who are expected to launch strikes or attacks against India or against Indians in some territory. So this is what they mean.
Shahid Latif Saab, there has been a confusion regarding the site of the strike. Some are saying that, you know, probably it's the Balakot inside KP, which is obviously considered, which would be considered a deep strike inside Pakistan. But at the same time, if we refer to the tweet of DGISPR, he's claiming that, you know, it is near Muzaffarabad. But then that Balakot nearing Muzaffarabad is not very near to the Muzaffarabad. So there has been a bit of confusion regarding that. You think that this needs official clarification? justification, one, and also, most importantly, what should our response be now? How are we going to respond to this situation? The National Security Council meeting was held, and they said, you know, Pakistan is going to choose its time and, you know, place of strike. But at the same time, Imran Khan, our Prime Minister, had mentioned that, you know, if India attacks, we're not going to wait. So how should we respond to this now on a military as well as diplomatic level?
Okay. First, the confusion about the name. As I learned, that Balakot is the name of a small village in the Muzaffarabad zone. So it is not the Balakot that you are alluding to, which is part of KPK and which is 100 miles away. Certainly, it is the Balakot which is in this region, and it's an insignificant small place. So that is the answer to your first question. And now you come to the more important part, in which you say that, yes, we've been attacked. There are no questions about it. And once our territory has been penetrated, it is certainly a serious violation of our independence and sovereignty. How can we allow this to happen? Or how someone can undermine your sovereignty by entering your territory? And that too with evil intentions. So this is right. Now, the next and the more important part of your question is, what do we need to do? I mean, it is accepted that, yes, it is an attack. And being a sovereign country, we do not permit an enemy in the neighboring area to come and penetrate our territory, and that too with the intentions to attack. And they have dropped weapons in that area, whatever be the intentions, but that has happened. Now, this is a very serious part, that what do we need to do? As our Prime Minister had made a statement, if you recall, which had two parts. One, in which he had said, if you want us to take action and sit with you and talk, you must give us concrete, solid proofs. And only then we will be able to take action. But if you fail to do that, then let me warn you, and if you indulge in any adventurism, the reaction will certainly be there, and it will be a harsh reaction. We will not think about it. It is bound to be there. So those were the words on which he stressed. So going by the words of the Prime Minister, I think, as they decided in today's meeting, that they have already decided that we will react. Reaction will be there. But certainly, the reaction should be such that we do not give any hints about our reaction, then it will lose its importance. The onus of reaction, the way we need to react, where we would react, how we would react, is my domain, and I don't want to share it with anybody for it to be most effective. So therefore, I don't even want to guess it. The whole day, this has been the question asked, and I deliberately did not even put a time frame on this, because then you sacrifice the aspect of surprise, which in such cases can simply not be sacrificed. So there will be a reaction. It is decided at the most opportune time, which we will decide, the most opportune place, and in the most opportune manner. And this, I would leave it to the leadership of our armed forces and the leadership of this country.
Shahid Latif Saab, do you think that ahead of the Indian elections, Prime Minister Modi was trying to basically assuage the public anger? It was a calculated bet to do so, but at the same time minimize the risk of a major Pakistani military response and hence this sort of an attack?
Yes, that is right. I'm sure Mr. Modi, who is highly ambitious and a clueless person himself, having a terrorist background, he would sacrifice anything over his personal interest. I mean, not realizing the intricacies involved in such an action and the dangers in the aftermath of such an attack, where both countries happen to be nuclear and the population of the country is over 1.5 billion. So he has put at stake and compromised the security of this region, the lives of so many people, and the widespread destruction that such an attack can cause. And we all know it, as we call it, mad, mutually assured destruction. which can come through any nuclear attack. Although any responsible state, and we are one of those responsible states that don't even want to talk of nuclear war. But a person like Modi is least conscious, and he has put at stake, like I'm saying, the safety of this entire region and the safety of 1.5 billion people should it escalate to that level. But in order to, like you said, assuage the anger, and secondly, to achieve his very limited and myopic aim of winning elections, that means he can sell anything and he can put to stake anything regarding his country and regarding this region.
There's a recent development happening right now that, you know, there's an OIC session coming up, and India has been invited as the guest of honor. Now, there's a suggestion coming up from different circles that we should boycott the OIC session, especially because of India's inclusion as a guest of honor. Do you think that boycotting the session will actually help our case? Because another point of view that is coming up is that, you know, it's better to do an alternative by instead of boycotting the session, why not move a resolution on Kashmir issue and embarrass India by getting it approved at the OIC? But definitely that is going to require unprecedented diplomacy. Do you think that is a possibility?
Yes, this is a very valid point. And once again, many questions are being asked, and this topic is under very serious discussion. And on one hand, yes, it will be an emotional reaction that we don't end up at a place where our enemy, the strongest enemy that we have in the form of our neighbor India, and the atrocities that they are committing in Kashmir, which are unprecedented, and we accept their foreign secretary or foreign minister as the chief guest in OIC meeting, forthcoming meeting. So that is one part. And the other part is go there and lodge your protest and let the public, let the world know about India, and you move your resolution in the light of UN resolutions on Kashmir and let the OIC members know the real face of India, and we should try and expose them as much as we can. As far as the first part is concerned, I think I'm not too sure whether this whole session has been distributed in parts and Sushma Swaraj is the chief guest in a session. I'm not sure. If it is divided into sessions, then the session in which she is the chief guest, we should definitely boycott. And if she is the chief guest over the entire session and proceedings, then I think we'll really have to put our heads together and see where do we have more benefit. And certainly the place that offers more benefit, I think, is the place where we should go and lodge a protest and put this aside, that she has been invited as a chief guest. I think this is a bitter pill that we should be able to swallow.
ये समझते हैं कि आप पाकिस्तान के ऊपर कुछ किसी किस्म का हमला करेंगे, पाकिस्तान रिटेलिएट करने का सोचेगा नहीं, पाकिस्तान रिटेलिएट करेगा।